Angiotensin receptor blockers having the action on the direct receptors, that is angiotensin 1 receptor or angiotensin 2 receptor. That means the drugs will going to bind on the site directly to inhibit the particular action of that angiotensin at that receptor. So what they will do, they will going to bind that site and will occupy the receptor site and prevent the binding of angiotensin 2 or angiotensin 1 on that angiotensin receptor site. So by that way, they have the very profound antihypertensive effect. What it mean by profound? Profound means very strong antihypertensive effect they are possessing. So they are present on the surface of the target cells, these receptors present on the target cells, and most of the physiological action of angiotensin are mediated via angiotensin 1 receptor, while the transducer mechanism by which the AT1 inhibitors act is different in tissues, show different mechanism. Means we can say where in the kidney or in the heart or in the different locations they have the different mechanism of action. So like here you can see the phospholipase C, inositol triphosphate and diacylglycerol mechanism. By this mechanism, they will inhibit the blood pressure or increase in blood pressure in the vascular and visceral smooth muscles contraction. Means in our body, there is a different types of tissue. So vascular and visceral smooth muscle, where the this pathway that we have studied, you might have studied in your previous pharmacology one, the different transducer mechanisms of drug action. That means the G protein receptors have the different kinds of mechanism through which they possess the physiological action. So this is one of the mechanism by which inhibition, we can get the antihypertensive effect. And in heart, here in myocardium and in vascular smooth muscle at angiotensin 1 receptor, that mediates the long-term effect by monoamine phosphatase kinase. So here, by this way, they are having the antihypertensive effect, and in vascular muscle, they are having the antihypertensive effect by this way. Okay. So the example of angiotensin 1 receptor blocker is the losartan, that is very much specific at angiotensin 1 receptor, that is specific or selective AT1 blocker. So here again, the losartan is one of the antagonist and inverse agonist of AT1 receptor. It does not interfere with the other receptors except the thromboxane A2 receptor. It blocks all the actions of angiotensin 2, that is vasoconstriction, sympathetic stimulation, aldosterone release, and renal actions of salt and water reabsorption. No inhibition of angiotensin converting enzyme takes place. Then here you can see what is the comparison with ACE inhibitors. The losartan is superior than the ACE inhibitors. Means if the patient is suffering from hypertension, we can use losartan so that we can get the very much rapid relief from the hypertension. So comparative than the ACE inhibitors, the losartan is very much superior. The pharmacokinetic parameters are mentioned here. Here you can see absorption is not affected by the food, but it has, unlike ACE inhibitors, its bioavailability is low. Means when we are take the captopril, enalapril, ramipril, all these are having the higher amount of bioavailability comparative to losartan. It is highly bound to the plasma protein and it do not enter or do not cross the blood-brain barrier. Okay. Adverse effects are like here you can see the phytopathic like ACE inhibitors and not to be administered in the pregnancy. We can see lower incidence of angioedema, then available as 25 and 50 milligram tablets. Okay, those are certain tablets. Then next class of antihypertensive drug is the beta adrenergic blockers. In that, again, the subclassification, it mentions the non-selective adrenergic blockers, that is propranolol, like nadolol, timolol, pindolol, labetalol, and others are selective beta blockers like metoprolol, like atenolol, esmolol, and bitoxolol. Okay, all beta blockers similar antihypertensive effect irrespective of additional properties, means all these are having the same kind of mechanism of action, the beta adrenergic blocking. That means they will block the beta 1 and beta 2 receptors. These are the beta receptors present in our body, and these will get blocked. Why the antihypertensive effect occurs due to the beta adrenergic blockers? Because the beta receptors are involved in the hypertension, that means the vasoconstriction. And we also saw that when the vasoconstriction takes place or increased cardiac output takes place, the increase in the blood pressure takes place. So we are making it inhibition. We are preventing the vessels from constriction and decreasing the cardiac output so that the blood pressure will not increase. Okay. So here you can see the reduction of cardiac output, but no change in blood pressure initially. But slowly after treatment, the blood pressure will start to come to normal. Okay. So by this way, the beta adrenergic blockers will act. They reduce the noradrenaline release and central sympathetic outflow reduction. That means the main adrenergic mediator, that is neurotransmitter, is the noradrenaline. Okay, so noradrenaline, when you're going to bind to beta receptors, it will cause the increase in blood pressure or increase the sympathetic outflow. But by inhibiting the action on these receptors, they will decrease the noradrenaline release and will decrease the sympathetic outflow so that the blood pressure will fall. The next is the advantages. So here you can see it is having the advantages, as they will not have the postural hypertension action, then no salt water retention, then low incidence of side effects, low cost of beta adrenergic blockers. Then some other disadvantages, like they will cause the fatigue, lethargy, decreased work capacity, loss of libido, that is impotence, cognitive defects, forgetfulness may occur for the longer periods of treatment. Therefore, cardioselective drugs are preferred now. So specifically, cardioselective drugs are preferred by to avoid this kind of disadvantages or drawbacks. The next is the alpha adrenergic blockers. The example is the prazosin. So here prazosin is a prototype drug of alpha blockers, and this cause the reduction in total peripheral resistance. Here TPR means what? Total peripheral resistance and mean blood pressure. Also reduction in venomotor tone and pooling of blood, that reduces the cardiac output, and ultimately we will get the antihypertensive effect here. Okay, so alpha adrenergic blocker, prazosin is one of the alpha 1 adrenergic blocker. Again, there is another receptor, that is alpha 2, that is also get blocked. So by this alpha adrenergic blockers. So non-selective will act on alpha 1 as well as alpha 2, while selective alpha 1 will act on selectively on the alpha 1 receptor only, and selective alpha 2 receptor blockers will act on the alpha 2 receptors only. Okay, like phentolamine and phenoxybenzamine. Okay, all these are non-selective one, and prazosin is one of the selective one alpha adrenergic blockers. So the next antihypertensive class is the calcium channel blockers. So here you can see these calcium channel blockers are having the different subclasses when we divide as per them their structure. So these are some phenyl alkylamines, that is verapamil, that is one of the example of phenyl alkylamines. Then next is the benzothiazepines. Then next is the dihydropyridines. So dihydropyridines are again having the classification as per their generation of evolution, the first generation, second generation and third generation. In this you can see the first generation is nifedipine, then isradipine, nicardipine, phelodipine, and right now third generation is the amlodipine. So all these are the calcium channel blockers. Here these calcium channel blockers have the very important mechanism of action in control of the blood pressure. The same thing happens here. The calcium has a very important role in the physiology of contraction of the heart. That means the increased calcium amount in the sarcoplasmic reticulum of the heart will increase the contraction force of the heart. Due to the contraction force of the heart, there is an increase in the cardiac output and force of contraction. And due to this, the increase in blood pressure may take place. So these calcium channel blockers, these drugs will inhibit the entry of calcium, will inhibit the entry of calcium inside the heart and will prevent the excitation and contraction. And due to this, the heart will remain slow, and normally there is an action takes place, and the cardiac output also get decreased, force of contraction get decreased. Due to this, the ultimately the blood pressure will not rise, or the antihypertensive effect will be achieved. Okay, so by this way, the calcium channel blockers are having very important role in our antihypertensive drug therapy. There are two types of calcium channels. There, that is the L type of calcium channel and T type of calcium channel and N type of calcium channel. So normally the L type of channels admit the calcium and causes the depolarization and excitation, contraction, and phosphorylation of this myosin light chain and contraction of vascular smooth muscle and elevation of the BP. This is the pathophysiology of blood pressure rise. While by blocking the L type of channels, the smooth muscle get relaxed and negative chronotropic, inotropic and chronotropic effect in the heart takes place. So positive chronotropic effect means increase in heart rate. Positive inotropic effect means increase in force of contraction. While negative chronotropic and negative inotropic means decrease in the all the force of contraction as well as our heart rate. By decreasing this heart rate and force of contraction, we are decreasing our blood pressure too. Okay, so this is the advantages of this calcium channel blockers. So they are don't have any many disadvantages, like they don't have the dizziness, fatigue and this kind of effect. They do not compromise the hemodynamics, no impairment of the work capacity. The patient's work capacity will be normal. Then no sedation or CNS effect. And the calcium channel blockers can be given to asthma, angina or peripheral vascular disease patients. There is no contraindications in these types of diseases with the calcium channel blocker. Minimal effect of the on the quality of life means when we are taking the calcium channel blockers drugs, that is amlodipine, nifedipine or diltiazem, verapamil, any kind of drug, will not have any other side effects on the quality of life. Means the patient can live normally. Okay, by this way it will give us very important critical benefit. Sometimes it is contraindicated in the unstable angina, then heart failure patients, hypotension patients, post infarct cases, severe aortic stenosis patients. In these patients, the calcium channel blockers are avoided or contraindicated. Now the doses here you can see there are about 2.5, 5 and 10 milligram tablets are available of amlodipine. Nimodipine 30 milligram tablet and 10 milligram per 50 ml injection is also available. The next is the vasodilators. So vasodilators, the name itself indicate they're dilating the blood vessels. They're directly acting on blood vessel and dilates them or increases the lumen size. So here you can see the hydralazine, that drug which combined with the receptors in the endothelium of the arterioles, and there it will release the nitric oxide, and this causes the relaxation of vascular smooth muscle. And due to the relaxation, the dilation takes place, and when the higher amount of blood is flowing, there is no resistance occur, and the blood pressure will not be increased, and the blood pressure reading will come to the normal. Okay, so subsequently fall in blood pressure takes place. So when we can use the vasodilators, here the users has been mentioned. When moderate hypertension, the first line fails, means if the patient is taking the thiazides, diuretics and other drugs, still the blood pressure is not coming to the normal. In that condition or in that state, we can use the vasodilators. And hypertension in pregnancy, here you can use the dose of 25 to 50 milligram. Next vasodilator is the minoxidil. So minoxidil is another potent vasodilator, and it is used as a antihypertensive drug and in a treatment of alopecia. So alopecia is nothing but the hair growth treatment in patients who lost their hairs. In that patient, the minoxidil is given. Okay, then more often in alopecia to promote the hair growth, the minoxidil is given. The next drug is the sodium nitroprusside, that is given, which have the rapid and consistent acting vasodilation action. Here again, it is having the mechanism of action as this RBCs convert the nitroprusside to nitric oxide, and the nitric oxide is main mediator for the relaxation of the blood vessels and will decrease the blood pressure. Then next are the centrally acting drugs. So these are the peripherally acting drugs. Here up till now, directly on the site of action on the blood vessel and the heart. Some are the drugs which are having the action on the receptors which are present in the brain, and by making them inhibiting them, they can decrease the blood pressure directly from the central nervous system. So one of the example in this kind is the alpha methyl dopa. So this methyl dopa can be given when the other treatments are failed, and directly from the centrally we have to inhibit the blood pressure. So what it do, the methyl dopa is one of the precursor of dopamine and noradrenaline. So methyl dopa is one of the intermediate in the formation of these neurotransmitters which are responsible for the increase in the blood pressure. So what it do, it get converted to alpha methyl noradrenaline, which acts on alpha 2 receptors in the brain and causes the inhibition of the adrenergic discharge in medulla, and this will directly cause the fall in the blood peripheral vascular resistance and fall in the blood pressure. Means we need to take the vasodilators and other things. What is this methyl dopa is doing, they will inhibit the adrenergic outflow from the medulla oblongata by inhibiting the alpha 2 receptors in the brain, and this will cause the peripheral vascular resistance, fall in the peripheral vascular resistance and fall in the blood pressure. But this as these are acting on the central nervous system, they have the various side effects or adverse effects, like they will cause the cognition impairment. That means the memory power may get affected. Postural hypotension. This is very important condition here. By using the methyldopa, if the patient is taking these drugs, sometimes when we are sitting and when get stand, that time the hypotension takes place. So that is called as the postural hypotension. Then positive Coombs test. So not used in this kinds of impairments. Then another drug is the clonidine. This is one of the imidazoline derivative and which is a partial agonist of central alpha 2 receptor and right now not frequently used due to the tolerance and the withdrawal hypertension effect. Okay, so remaining things you can take from the book. So here what happened? The tolerance means what? Tolerance is what the higher amount of clonidine needs repeatedly, and this will cause the habitual effect in the patient. The patient may get habituated with this clonidine drug, so not frequently used. So is there any doubts in this topic right now?